and girls. I hope you know how much I miss you in the library and how much the books are wanting you to come back to school and read them. But for today, we're going to talk about a genre called tall tales. Now, remember, a genre is a category or a type of books, okay? So today we're going to talk about tall tales. And this tale is not the tale that you see on an animal. This tale is like a story tale. A tall tale is a fictional story that stretches the truth. So it takes the truth and it makes it bigger than what it is, okay? Tall tale characters usually have people that have superhuman powers. So they're stronger or have some sort of power that is more than a normal human has. The story setting usually takes place during a real time in history. Then the last characteristic, and it's the biggest one that makes a story a tall tale, is that the story has lots of exaggeration. Now, exaggeration is a big word. What exaggeration means is when you take something small and you make it bigger than what it is. Like when you see a little spider in your house and you get scared and you say, "That spider was the size of a dump truck." That's an exaggeration, okay? So today I'm going to read you a tall tale, and we're going to talk about the exaggerations that we hear inside this tall tale, okay? The story is called Johnny Appleseed. And it is a tall tale retold and illustrated by Stephen Kellogg. The publisher is HarperCollins, and they have released the copyright for me to be able to read this aloud to you today. So, Johnny Appleseed, a tall tale retold and illustrated by Stephen Kellogg. John Chapman, who later became known as Johnny Appleseed, was born on September 26, 1774, when the apples on the tree surrounding his home in Leominster, Massachusetts, were as red as the autumn leaves. Johnny's first years were hard. His father left the family to fight in the Revolutionary War. The Revolutionary War was the war that the Americans fought against the British to make the United States of America its own country. So his father was left the family to fight in the Revolutionary War, and his mother and his baby brother both died before his second birthday. That makes me sad that he lost his mother and his brother when he was so young. By the time John turned six, his father had remarried and settled in Longmeadow, Massachusetts. Within a decade, their little house was overflowing with 10 more children. Ooh, I cannot imagine. Can you see all those children and animal there? That's a lot. Nearby was an apple orchard. Like most early American families, the Chapmans picked their apples in the fall, stored them in cellars for winter eating, and used them to make sauces, cider, vinegar, and apple butter. Ooh, I just had a Texas self connection. Apple butter is my absolute favorite. John loved to watch the spring blossoms slowly turn into the glowing fruit of autumn. Watching the apples grow inspired in John a love of all of nature. He often escaped from the boisterous family household to the tranquil woods. The animals sensed his gentleness and trusted him. As soon as John was old enough to leave, he set out to explore the vast wilderness of the West. He cleared a plot of land and planted a small orchard with the pouch of apple seeds that he had carried with him. John walked hundreds of miles through the Pennsylvania forest. Now, you've got to think, this is happening in a time of history where they didn't have cars. So he walked everywhere he went. I cannot imagine walking that far through the forest. So John walked hundreds of miles through the Pennsylvania forest, living like the Indians he had befriended on the trail. As he traveled, he cleared the land for many more orchards. He was sure the pioneer families would be arriving before long, and he looked forward to supplying them with apple trees. When a storm struck, he found shelter in a hollow log or built a lean-to. On clear nights, he stretched out under the stars. Over the next few years, John continued to visit and care for his new orchards. The winters slowed him down, but he survived happily on a diet of butternuts. Now, my inner voice is telling me that would be hard to survive in the wilderness during the winters with all that snow and just eat butternuts. I can't imagine only eating one thing for several months in a row. One spring, he met a band of men who boasted that they could lick their weight in wildcats. Now, boys and girls, when that says lick their weight, it doesn't mean literally licking the wildcats. It means, like, outpowering them or stronger than them. They were amazed to hear that John wouldn't hurt an animal and had no use for a gun. My inner voice tells me that that gives us information about Johnny and tells us a little bit about him. If he didn't want to hurt an animal, that means he took good care of them and lived with them in nature and liked them. They challenged John to compete at wrestling, the favorite frontier sport. He suggested a more practical contest, a tree chopping match. The woodsman eagerly agreed. Can you see the picture and how fast they're all chopping the trees down? When the sawdust settled, there was no question about who had come out on top. John was pleased that the land for his largest orchard had been so quickly cleared. He thanked the exhausted woodsmen for their help and began planting. So can you see all the other woodsmen are tired and laid down, and there's John. Johnny, he's still standing there with his axe and ready to go. During the next few years, John continued to move westward. When he ran out of apple seeds, he hiked to the eastern cider presses to replenish his supply. Before long, John's plantings were spread across the state of Ohio. Meanwhile, pioneer families were arriving in search of home sites and farmland. John had located his orchards on the routes he thought they'd be traveling. As he had hoped, the settlers were eager to buy his young trees. John went out of his way to lend a helping hand to his new neighbors. Often he would give the trees away. People affectionately called him Johnny Appleseed, and he began using that name. He particularly enjoyed entertaining children with tales of his wilderness adventures and stories from the Bible. In 1812, the British incited the Indians to join them in another war against the Americans. The settlers feared that Ohio would be invaded from Lake Erie. It grieved Johnny that his friends were fighting each other, but when he saw the smoke of burning cabins, he ran through the night shouting a warning at every door. Now remember, he's on foot. He still doesn't have a car or a horse to go tell it to warn people. After the war, people urged Johnny to build a house and settle down. He replied that he lived like a king in his wilderness home, and he returned to the forest he loved. During his long absence, folks enjoyed sharing their recollections of Johnny. They retold his stories, and sometimes they even exaggerated them a bit. Some recalled Johnny sleeping in a treetop hammock and chatting with the birds. That's an exaggeration, because we know that birds don't come land on people and chat with them, do they? Others remembered that a rattlesnake had attacked his foot. Fortunately, Johnny's feet were as tough as elephant's hide, so the fangs didn't penetrate them. Look how big that rattlesnake is. I think that's an exaggeration, which makes this a tall tale. It was said that Johnny had once tended a wounded wolf and then kept him for a pet. An old hunter swore he'd seen Johnny frolicking with a bear family. Now, frolicking means playing and having a good time with. The storytellers outdid each other with tall tales about his feats of survival in the untamed wilderness. So if you look at this picture, this is exaggeration, because do humans play and roll around in the ground with bears? No. We look at all the other tall tales. He's got an eagle that's soaring with him. Here's a huge fish as he's going down in a canoe. All exaggerations of Johnny Appleseed. As the years passed, Ohio became too crowded for Johnny. He moved to the wilds of Indiana, where he continued to clear land for his orchards. When the settlers began arriving, Johnny recognized some of the children who had listened to his stories. Now they had children of their own. So that tells us how much time has passed because now children that he used to tell stories to, they're adults and they have children of their own. So it's been many years. It made Johnny's old heart glad when they welcomed him as a beloved friend and asked to hear his tales again. When Johnny passed 70, it became difficult for him to keep up with his work. Then in March of 1845, while trudging through a snowstorm near Fort Wayne, Indiana, he became ill for the first time in his life. Now, I don't know for sure, but I'm going to say that's an exaggeration, that he had never been sick before ever in his life. Johnny asked for shelter in a sailor's cabin, and a few days later, he died there. Curiously, Johnny's stories continued to move westward without him. Folks maintained that that they'd seen him in Illinois, or that he'd greeted them in Missouri, Arkansas, which is our state, or Texas. Others were certain that he'd planted trees on the slopes of the Rocky Mountains or in the California's distant valleys. Even today, people still claim they've seen Johnny Appleseed. Do you think anybody today is still seeing Johnny Appleseed? That's the end of our story, boys and girls. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you'll join me for another tall tale soon. Thank you.